couple weeks ago, the Handel and Haydn Society was playing Mozart's Masonic Funeral at the Symphony Hall in Boston. And when the music came to an end, and before anybody had a chance to even begin the applause, a young boy shouted out, "Wow!" Of course, at that point, the applause pretty much went to everybody just sort of laughing and cracking up because they were so amazed that somebody really said what it felt like to hear this beautiful piece of music. We all become so accustomed to, yes, wonderful, you know. Maybe somebody whistles or shouts out or whatever, but it's all sort of stage. It's all part of the performance, you know. Can you imagine what the orchestra would feel like if there was just silence out there? You know, we wouldn't do that to them. But nobody expected someone to just say exactly what they felt right from the heart. So this started a search across northern New England for the wow child, as they called him. And he turned out to be a 9-year-old boy named Ronan Matten from New Hampshire. It turns out that Ronan is a huge music fan and has a very unique way of expressing his appreciation for great music. The president of the Handel and Haydn Society, David Sneed, called Ronan's wow one of the most wonderful moments he had ever had in a concert hall. Yeah. You see, 9-year-old Ronan was doing what God made him to do. He was made to be a wow child. And so were you. You and I live our lives in the great symphony hall of the God who created us. We don't have to get a ticket. We don't have to go to a big city and try to find a place to put the car and then file in and sit in our assigned seat and wait for the show to begin. When you woke up this morning, the show was already going full bore. Whether you woke up to rain this morning or whether you woke up to bird songs or whatever it was, or in our case, usually it's a dog who has decided it's time to go outside. Whatever it is, you're already in the middle of God's symphony for this day. And you and I were created to be those who say, wow, to what God has done. Didn't you love it when the kids just came up here and showed us how to really praise God? Like, yeah, see? David wrote these words. He said in Psalm chapter 8, verse 1, "Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth." He begins this psalm with God's personal name. When you see the words L-O-R-D in capital letters, that's just the way our Bibles translate the personal name of God, Yahweh. And Lord, our Lord, the second use of the word Lord means what we customarily think of the word as, the one who is in charge, the king. So he says, Lord. He's referring to God by his personal name. You see, it's the Lord himself, Yahweh himself, who is the song that energizes his creation. His name represents his very essence in Hebrew culture and throughout that part of the world. To say a person's name meant to evoke everything about them. To even have the right to know someone's name and to say their name and use their name was to have access to them and all of their blessings. We think of it more like in terms of passwords, right? Well, what's your password? People come into the church and they want to get on the internet. And what's the password? And when we give them that, we give them access to something they wouldn't have otherwise. And when we have God's name, when God says, "I reveal my name to you," he's saying, "I'm inviting you into a relationship." Relationship with the greatest being of this entire universe, who says, "I want to know you in a personal way." Not only does he give us his name, but he says, "I've called you by name." God's revealing himself to us just by giving us his name. And David says, wow, in that relationship where I am in a first name basis with you, Lord, and I see everything you've done. He says, how majestic is your name in all the earth? Or, wow, there's no one else like you in the whole world. Now, like David, we were created to worship and praise the God who created us. And the God who rescued us from sin. We were made to say, wow. That's not something we have to learn how to do. I mean, the kids get it. We forget it. Right? The kids just let out what they're feeling. Sometimes that's a good thing. Sometimes we're working on that with them. But it's just there. We kind of learn to be circumspect, and we kind of are kind of worried about who's around and, you know, who's watching and who isn't. And I remember going to church as a kid, and when you sang with your hands like this. Well, then when I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, I began going to an Assembly of God church. And I walked in, and everybody was going like this. I'm in the back row. Well, I'm not doing that, you know. Well, then it was like, but it's still the back row, you know. Well, then after a while, it got to where we all did this and nobody dared do this, right? I mean, you're scripted. And it's all good, whatever you choose to do, but I mean, we could get so busy, like, am I the only, is this a halfway up or a three-quarter? Oh, yeah, there's somebody else. Okay, I'll give another inch, you know. Instead of just, whoa, God, you're amazing. We were created to do that. David says about God's glory, verse 8, end of the verse, you've set your glory in the heavens. And one of the beautiful things about living just a little bit in the country here in Vermont is that if I don't look over towards St. Albans where there's a lot of light, and look the other direction, I can still see stars. And a lot of people in our country can't even do that. They can't even know what David's saying here. You've set your glory in the heavens. But we have that opportunity to go out on a starry night. And just this summer, I just can't wait to go out and see that Milky Way stretched all the way from one horizon to the other and pick out all my favorite stars and constellations and look for shooting stars when August comes around. We see that glory, and that makes sense to us. We can look there and go, oh, yeah, that's how big God is. God's bigger than even that. We know even how much bigger that universe is than David could have ever imagined. That there are 100 billion galaxies, not just the Milky Way, our galaxy. But David says that when it comes to the actual work of praising God, or what he calls building a fortress of praise, a fortress of praise, here on planet Earth, the job falls first and foremost to the littlest ones among us. After talking about God's glory in the heavens, look at what he says in verse 2. Through the praise of children and infants, you've established a stronghold, a fortress against your enemies to silence the foe and the avenger. Children and infants. The word infant literally means nursing babies. Through the praise of the littlest ones among us. The baby you still have to hold in your arms because you're still learning how to pick up his or her head just to eat. And that's this little one that you'll have to put to bed and you have to change the diaper and you'll be up at 2 a.m. And that little one, that one that makes a lot of noise, doesn't say a whole lot of stuff, but makes a whole lot of racket. He's saying that noise is the beginning of what that person was created for, building a fortress of praise. We were created specifically to say wow to the mighty works of God. And nobody does it better than a child. Now, how can it possibly be that the praise of a child or the praise of any one of us when we step into, like what Claude mentioned this morning, being like a child to enter the kingdom of heaven, how can it be that that praise establishes a stronghold or a fortress against God's greatest enemies? He's not saying here against our greatest enemies, but he's saying against God's greatest enemies. Well, who are God's enemies? Well, if you think about the creation story, what God did was he took a disordered, unorganized mass and turned it into an ordered world. He conquered chaos. He even made the pathway for us to conquer death itself, which Jesus himself has promised to do for all of us. Those are God's enemies, the very forces that are so much bigger than the things we get worked up about and the arguments that we have in our politics and our society and so on, the dark forces that cause whole nations to go astray. The things that would undermine even our best intentions that we would hardly even be aware of. What Paul would call principalities and powers in the heavenly realm, spiritual realm. Those forces, those dark forces, you would think we would have to get all the smartest and brightest people together and pay them a whole lot of money to figure out some sort of spiritual algorithm to kind of conquer this thing once and for all. And God says, no, I got an easier plan. Go to kids' church. You'll find out everything you need to know. Because the fortress is built out of people saying, wow, God is bigger. Not how can we do this and how can we fix that and whose fault was it that this happened and on and on and on and on. He says, no, the fix is raise your gaze up to me. See what's really true. See who is truly the king and who's truly in charge. Out of the mouths of children and infants, you've established praise. David puzzled over this whole thing. He said, now wait a minute. Your glory's over the heavens, but the praise is in the little ones? Look at what he says in verses 3 and 4. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you've set in place. What is mankind that you're mindful of them? Human beings that you care for them. Did you ever feel that way? It's like, big universe, Lord. I think it takes one visit to the Grand Canyon to just let you know how tiny you are. Now you think you can handle it, right? So you drive and you drive. Maybe you flew to Phoenix or somewhere, and then you get the rented car and you're driving along. And if you've ever driven to the Grand Canyon, you basically drive over a flat desert for the last, what, hour and a half? Is that about right? I mean, it's just nothing, absolutely nothing to look at. And then you pay your $20, and then you, still nothing. And then you drive in, and there's people around, and you pull up to a parking lot, and you get out, and you walk, and all of a sudden it's like, what happened here? What happened? Gigantic. And that's what David says. Who are we? Who are we in the grand scheme? But then he answers his own question when he writes Psalm 8, 5 to 8. But you have made them, human beings, you, me, a little lower than the angels. And the other translation of that is a little lower than God. Made in his image, you see. And crowned them with glory and honor. You've made them rulers over the works of your hands. You put everything under their feet, all flocks and herds and the animals of the wild, the birds in the sky and the fish in the sea that swim in the paths of the seas. See, David says, God created you, created me, all of us, in his image to reflect him, to do his work here in this world. We have the assignment of bringing God's good creation order to our world, especially the other living creatures that we share it with. What's that mean, to bring God's creation order? Well, if you fixed breakfast this morning, you brought order into a place that otherwise would have been disordered. Just don't feed a little kid for a while and see what happens around the house. Don't feed the adults and you'll see what happens. The simplest things, when you pick your clothes up, when you put your clothes on, when you drove the car, oh, those are all acts of bringing order to what otherwise would be a chaotic world. When you show that expression of courtesy and love to someone else, when you forgive, something was said and something was not done and whatever, and you just have that attack already, you're locked and loaded and ready to just blast away, and then, no, that's not what Jesus would do. What would God do in this situation? And we choose to forgive and address the thing in a loving way, and we all move forward. When we show God's love to people around us, in our community, even people who may not understand us, people who may say very disparaging things about the God that we love and that we honor, and yet we respond not with evil for evil, but we return good for that which was badly intended. We bring God's order. That's what God created us to do. And you see, being a wild child, being someone who brings praise to God, brings that order into God's world. That's how we're building a fortress of praise. We're fulfilling the very mission that God gave us to do. In a very real way, everything we do is meant to be an act of worship and praise to our King and our Creator. You see, worship is not just singing a few songs on Saturday night or Sunday morning. And it's certainly not something that we delegate or that God delegated to just a few specialists who would come up here maybe and have a microphone or play a guitar or maybe would help out back in the booth. It's not something that you're either good at or you're not good at. Worship is what we were all created to do. Everything we do that enhances God's reputation in the world is an act of worship, first and foremost. Every time we obey him and acknowledge him as our Lord, we're shouting his praises. We're saying he's worth following, he's worth obeying, he's worth honoring more than all of these other things around me. And that's an act of praise. Every time we say thank you to him, we're building a fortress against all the dark forces that would destroy his world. You see, worship is creation work. Worship is the creation work. It's what we were created for. Instead of calling ourselves Homo sapiens, which means wise humans, we should see ourselves as Homo adorator, worshiping humans, because that's how God created us. And because we were created for worship, we cannot not worship. We are in worship mode, whether we realize it or not, every waking moment, and probably half the time we're asleep. We're always appreciating something. We're always recognizing that something is more wonderful and bigger and greater than ourselves. We're going to be giving our adoration, our affection, our attention, our praise to something or someone all the time. You can't turn it off. You can't stop doing it. Because we were wired by God, hardwired to appreciate. To appreciate something that's beautiful. To appreciate something that's big and strong. To respect that which brings protection and safety to us. We cannot not worship. A thousand things are competing for your worship right now. And some of them will become your gods if you're not careful. Believe me, our society is filled with all sorts of gods and would-be gods that would love to have your attention, that would love to think for you, that would love to tell you what you can and cannot do, that would love to have your money, that would love to have your time, and most of all, would love to have your soul. That's just how human societies work. Read back as far in history as you want, and you're going to find that people kept coming up, have always come up with things to worship, things that they think will bring that sense of satisfaction to that worship drive and will bring order to their world. But you were only created to worship one particular being, and that's the God who created you. God gave this command to his people in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 and 5. Hear, O Israel, the Lord, there we are again, the same Lord that David was praising. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord, your God, with all your heart and with all your soul, with all your strength. There's no room for multiple gods. There's no room to say, well, God gets this much of me, and then work gets this much of me, and then my relationships get this much, and on and on and on, divide ourselves up like some sort of worship pie, and we have to figure out how big of a piece of pie God gets this week or this day or this minute. Can't compartmentalize because we live in God's world. We don't live in a compartmentalized world. We don't step into a world where something else is God over here, and then the God who created us, well, yeah, he still has a little influence over here. It's all his. As the scripture says, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. He fills the whole place. No room for multiple gods. The Lord and the Lord alone is worthy of being loved with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. And you know something? That's what gives us our greatest fulfillment and is our greatest honor. Think about that symphony orchestra getting ready to play a piece of music in a symphony hall. And imagine that they needed, you know, one more clarinet, let's say. And so they go to someone and they invite that person to join the orchestra. Now, this is a world-class orchestra. And so here's this individual who's looking for a place to play music. Why, to be invited to play in that orchestra is a great honor. I mean, I'm sure that person, when they get that letter or they get that phone call or that email, first thing they do is they call their family members and they call their friends. Hey, can you believe it? I've been asked to play with such and such an orchestra. I'm going to be rehearsing with them. I'm going to be playing. I'll get some tickets. You can come and hear it. You have been recruited by God. You've been created by God to play in his orchestra. Why would you want to take that honor and set it aside to go play in something that couldn't make the music that you were made to play? See, it's our greatest honor that God would say, out of your mouth, out of your heart, out of your soul, is going to come the praise that builds a fortress against all the dark things in this world and lets a world see where their true light truly is. What an honor. What an honor to be able to just belong to him. See, that's what makes a child's worship and praise so powerful. That child can listen to Mozart and just say, wow. Doesn't care whether or not it's appropriate in the concert hall. Doesn't ask permission. His praise just explodes out of his spirit. Because at that moment, he was loving that music with all of his heart, with all his soul, with all his strength. That little kid got lost in that symphony hall, right? He was in it. And I mean, that music just filled him up. And there was nobody else around. And then when the music was over, he just exploded. And that's what God says. You can do that too. You just explode with me, God says. Just love me with all your heart, your soul, your strength. And the wow is just going to come out. It's going to come out in a thousand ways. That's what real worship looks like. So it's time to take worship out of any boxes we may have put it in. It isn't just something a few people are into. It isn't optional. It isn't just a particular genre of songs. It's not just part of our church service. And we fall into this trap, and we kind of talk about the worship set or the worship team or the worship time, and then we have the worship and then we have the word, as if they were supposed to be separate. Worship is a deep part of who we are. It informs our every decision, our every hope, our every dream. It's the carrier wave for every prayer. Because you see, when we're praying to the God that we honor and love and that we already know is majestic above all the earth. And so when we're talking to him, we're not trying to weasel something out of him. We're not just hoping that maybe this time my call will get through. You know, it's sort of like, your call is very important to us. Please listen to the next 30 minutes of terrible music. And I'll remind you every 2 minutes that your call is very important. That's not prayer. That's not prayer. Prayer just rides on the wave of our worship and honor of God. When we worship, it's not about us. It's not about what we think. It's not about whether my hands are supposed to be here or here. It's not about that. It's all about him. We can raise our hands to him in praise and adoration. We can sing and shout out his praise. We can express what's bubbling up inside us. That's what we were made to do. And you can do that in the car. You can do that in the shower. You can do that at the kitchen sink. You can do it without making a sound, just by thinking about him. You can just go out and say wow all the way on that walk you take on a nice day, and you see those beautiful flowers and just see the world coming to life. When we remind ourselves, wait a minute, he made all of this. And he shares it with us. Wow. And when you feel that, I don't know what you call it, something inside of just, oh, he's so wonderful. That's worship. So it's time to take our worship out of the box. It's time to dare to be a wow child in God's concert hall. Now, when we gather here at church, thanks to the people who have dedicated themselves to learning songs and playing instruments and running the technical equipment and just making sure that this all works, when we come to church, we're having an opportunity to recharge our worship batteries. You know, we weren't meant to just go do this all by ourselves, all alone, just sort of trying to figure it out. And after a while, you know, we may kind of lose our focus a little bit. So we come back, as you've done here today, and as we do each week. And the team takes us through a time of worship, which is sort of a quick recharge. Like, oh yeah, oh yes, that's who God is. I was forgetting how great he is in this area of my life because the problems were so big, or I got so distracted, or I was running around chasing this thing or that thing. But oh no, I'm refocusing. And what a wonderful time it is that we can do this. We can worship together, something we don't get to do the rest of the week. Now, some of you, however, are called by God to help be part of that recharge ministry, that worship ministry that helps open those doors for us, not just on a Sunday, but in many, many ways. It's been interesting, one of the young men in our church, several of them, are working with our kids to do worship with them. And what you saw happen up here didn't just happen. I mean, people worked hard with those kids. They've been working on those songs for a long time. And it was so amazing. I remember my wife said that Brian Kuzelis came into the nursery after he'd played his guitar for the kids in kids' church. He came into the nursery. And he just started to sit there and play worship songs. And she said, okay, now this is like one-year-olds, two-year-olds, two-and-a-half. Some of you have kids back there. She said, at first, all the kids just kept doing what they were doing. We're playing with the dolls, or playing with the trains, or playing with the cars. Yeah, but what do you think they were really doing? They're all listening like crazy. And then they start to come around the instrument, and then touch the instrument and pluck the strings. You see, it's out of the mouth of children that praise comes out. So there are ways that God can use you. You can use you in this room here. He can use you throughout the building to help pull that forth and help that grow and let praise come to life in our church. I was praying about our worship team a couple of months ago. Because, we've got just a small number of people who this past year have just worked very, very hard. When you come into church and it happens, it doesn't just happen that way. They were here on a Wednesday or a Thursday night doing a practice, and they were learning songs and learning their various parts and practicing the service. And then they come in before church and rehearse, and they do that Saturday, they do that Sunday. And I was just thinking, Lord, are there more people that you want to have? And he said to me, okay, what I need are people I've called. It's not just about being able to play this instrument or having a particular voice range or whatever. I'm looking for worshipers. Now, the Bible in the Old Testament called them the Levites. That was one of the tribes of Israel. And it was their job to produce the music, the worship. Back when Nehemiah was rebuilding the whole city of Jerusalem and he wanted to get church going again, and they have to have a temple, and they have to have priests, and they have to have sacrifices, and all this kind of stuff to do the way they did church. But his first thing was, I got to go find some Levites, because they do all the work. They do the ministry. They make the music. They play the instruments. They sing the songs. They teach us the songs. And I felt, that's what God's doing for us. So some of you are going to be feeling a calling. It is not just about a musical ability. That's a gift God gave you that he wants to use. Or it may be a technical ability to be working at the sound booth or working at the computer monitor or working as Mark is doing back there. Everybody look at Mark. He's making this all happen right now, see? The man with the iPad. That's the most important person in the room. But you might be able to step into a role like that. But it's going to come out of a sense of, God's called me to this. It's not just that I have some abilities. It's not just, that maybe I want to or I'm not sure. It's God's calling me. And that means I'm going to make time for that, and I'm going to make a commitment to that. And the fulfillment you're going to experience is going to be way beyond anything you can possibly imagine. We need you. We're called to build a fortress of worship and praise that will stand up against the dark forces that would destroy God's good world. We need you to be a part of that. We need you on a Sunday morning or a Saturday or whenever and throughout the rest of the week to just be letting your heart open up to God. And just be willing to say wow to him. In fact, the worship team will be having a worship night in June. They're working on the final date. It'll be a midweek time, and we'll be talking about that for the next several weeks. So I want to encourage you to be thinking about how that'll be an opportunity to come and maybe take the next step forward in your own praise journey. You see, it's time to tell our world and remind ourselves, as David finishes the psalm, Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Can we bow our heads together? Our Father, we thank you that we don't have to learn how to say wow to you. We've learned how not to say it. We've learned how to be too good, too cool, too nervous, too fearful, too shy, too sophisticated, too whatever, to say wow to you. But it's in there. It's in there. And Lord, just as the kids came up here and just and blessed us and blessed you with their dance and with their songs, in the same way, Lord, I pray you just release a wave, a revival of worship and praise in our hearts for you. I pray, Lord, that this could be the recharge, but that the real worship is going to go on all week long. It's going to go on even when things are tough. We're going to remember, wait a minute, oh Lord, my Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You're bigger than this problem. You're bigger than this situation. You're bigger than this hurt. You're bigger than what I did wrong. You forgive, you restore. But it all comes out of blessing you and loving you with all of our hearts and souls and strength. So I pray, Father, just a blessing of worship to come out over all of our congregation, those that are watching, those that are partaking of this service by the internet or by cable. I just want to pray a blessing and a freedom and a release to just find you in a new way and to light our world up with your praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, we're going to sing. One last chance for you to worship. Let's stand together. And if you have a prayer need, we'd love to have you come down to the front. The prayer team will be here for you. Well,